the contour of real-world objects, such as people, flowers, or cars, exist of mainly curved lines. To accurately select these curves, we use the Path tool. Its shortcut is P. To show you how the Path tool works, I have opened Sine. We'll explore the Path tool by drawing over this curved line. I will start at the top left. I click and hold the mouse button down. Now I drag a bit to the right. What I just did is I placed a point, which is the circle in the middle, and by dragging I pulled out of the circle these two arms. I will press the shift key down to show you that the circle is the center and the arms can be rotated around it. The arms can also be pulled out and pulled in. The function of the arms is to give the line I am going to draw curvature. Now I will place the second point at the bottom of the sine. I click and drag to the right again. As we can see, by using the arms, I am able to get a curved line. If I do not press shift, I can move the arms individually. And if I press shift, the arms will move as one, mirrored in their origin point. At the top, I click and drag again. And at the bottom, I click and drag. I click and drag, and click and drag. I want to close the path, so I will click a couple of times without dragging. To close the path, I press Ctrl and click on the first point. If I want to improve my path, I can click on a point and move it. And I can adjust the arms. Now open Circle. To draw a path around it, I will first place 4 points without dragging. 1 point at every 90 degrees. To help placing these 4 points here, I have placed 2 lines on a separate layer. I place my 4 points. To close the path, I control click on the first point. Next, I will add 4 new points in the middle of the straight lines. To add a new point, I press the control key and click on the line. A new point is added. Now I will drag the point to the edge, about in the middle. Let's zoom in a bit. To make the curve fit the circle, I press shift and drag the arms out just a bit further. I also do this for the other lines. I control click in the middle of the line and drag it to the edge. I press shift and position the arms to fit the curve. I control click and drag the point. I press shift and adjust the arms. And finally, control click, drag, press shift and adjust. Now our path is finished. The reason for drawing a path is to get a selection from it. To turn a path into a selection, I go to the Path panel. I click on the Path tab. I can now see the thumbnail of the path I drew. Like in the Layers panel, I can give the path a name. I double-click on the text, type Circle and press Enter. To turn the path into a selection, I click on the Path to Selection icon. Now we see the marching ends again. I will hide the path so I only see the selection by clicking on the Move tool. I will deselect by pressing Ctrl D to make a path visible again and automatically select the Path tool. Just double-click on the path thumbnail. Now let's create a second path by shift-clicking on the Create a New Path icon. I will draw a simple triangle and close the path by control-clicking on the first point. If I alt-click on the circle below, even though this path is not selected or visible, alt-clicking will give me its selection. Like we did with the rectangle and ellipse select tools, I can add, subtract, or intersect with a second selection, now coming from a path. This means I can add the triangle to the circle selection by Shift-Alt-clicking on the triangle thumbnail. Let's also do an intersection. I will create a third path by shift-clicking on the Create a New Path icon and draw a rectangle. To get an intersection of this rectangle with the selection, I will press Shift-Ctrl-Alt and click on the rectangle thumbnail. Then I click on the Move tool to hide the path and see my selection. Now let's practice with a real image. I open Coffee. Let's say in this image I would like to change the color of the background, but I want to leave the color of the mug unchanged. To do this, I will select the mug by drawing a path around it. When the mug is selected, I will place the mug on a separate layer on top. If I then change the color of the layer below, it won't affect the mug anymore, because the mug is on a separate layer. I select the Path tool and zoom in to about 400%. Here I can recognize a sine waveform. I will click and drag my first point at the top of the sine. Then I click and drag at the bottom of the sine. To make the curve fit, I will select a point and adjust the arm. The direction and length of the arms will form the curve. After adjusting, when you want to continue drawing, the last placed point has to be the active point. The active point has a transparent circle instead of a circle filled with white. So when the last placed point is white and you want to continue drawing, click on the last placed point to make it active. Then you can continue drawing. I click and drag a new point and adjust my handles. At this point, we get to a larger area. When the distance between two points gets longer, the curve will often be more difficult to draw. On the other hand, placing points too close to each other isn't effective and will be time-consuming. With a little practice, you will quickly start to recognize the natural existing sine forms, so you won't draw more curves than needed, and you won't try to draw several curves at the same time. I press Ctrl-Z to undo. For larger areas, I often use the method I used for drawing the circle. I click, so without dragging, to set a new point. Now at the place where there is the most distance between my line and the object, which is about here, I will Ctrl-click to place a new point. Then I drag this point to the edge. Remember, to continue drawing, I first have to click on the last point to make it active. To navigate, I press my scroll wheel and drag. And I place a new point. I will now finish selecting the mug without commenting. Now we have a path around the mug. However, we must not forget the inside of the handle. Drawing a new path inside a path will automatically exclude this area from the selection. Now our path is complete. In the Path panel, I alt-click on the thumbnail to turn the path into a selection. I press V to select the Move tool and open the Layers panel. To place the mug on a new layer, I will press Ctrl-J. In the Layers panel, I am also able to Alt-click on the layer thumbnail. The selection I get will come from the existing pixels that are on that layer. As we can see, Alt-clicking on the mock layer will give me the same selection as Alt-clicking on the mock path. And, like in the Path panel, a layer doesn't have to be selected or visible to get a selection from it. In the Layers panel, we are also able to add, subtract and intersect selections based on the existing pixels on that layer. The same key combinations are used. So Shift-Alt-clicking will add the pixels of a layer to the selection. Ctrl-Alt-clicking will subtract the pixels from a layer from the selection. And Shift-Ctrl-Alt-clicking will give me an intersection of the pixels on a layer and the selection. The mock has now been placed on a separate layer, above the background. I can now change the color of the background. I select the background layer and press Ctrl-U to open Hue Saturation. To bring the color of the background closer to the color of the mock, I drag the Hue to about 140. In the next lecture, we will explore how to select color